starts with the title, and but it's a wonderful message tonight, and we thank you for being with us.
Yes, the title of the message tonight is Trust, Loyalty, and Faithfulness. We'll be looking at these three words and how they relate to each other. And sometimes I just like to give the bottom line. The bottom line is all those words mean faith. And we'll get to that in a moment. But when you think about faith, you may think about some statements that your local congregation has said. These are the statements that we believe. And then you'd say, well, there's some other things that we don't believe. And so if you wrote down some statements about what you believe and I write down some statements about what I believe, we might not be in agreement on that. But you know what is happening in Ephesians 4? We're all coming into the unity of the faith. Amen. So we're all going to come into unity of the faith. So it obviously cannot be on a set of statements that you agree with and a set of statements that I agree with. It has to be something bigger than that. And that's what we're going to be looking at tonight, because these three words all are closely related, and they're basically saying, excuse me, the same thing: trust, loyalty, and faithfulness, because our faith is not in a set of statements.
Hallelujah.
Our faith is in a person. And we have, if we have faith in that person, we're going to trust that person. And we're going to be loyal to that person. And we're going to be faithful to that person. And of course, the person is the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the King of Kings. And so this message today will help you strengthen your faith and to realize you don't have to have a set of five or six things that you agree with and that's your faith. No, it's not about a set of statements. It's about a person. And I want to look at a couple of verses to begin with, but I want to say that we have faith, and we can have faith because our God is faithful. And if our God wasn't faithful, we couldn't have faith in him. But because God is faithful, and this is shown throughout the Bible, but that's what it's all about. It's not, our concept of faith does not start with us. It starts with him. God is faithful, and therefore we can trust him because he is faithful. We can be loyal to him because he is faithful. And we can be faithful because he is faithful.
Ooh, hallelujah.
And so it's not starting with us. It's starting with our God. Our God is faithful. So I want to read two verses to begin with, because this is the core of the message. Go ahead, Sherry.
Okay. This is out of the first verse is out of the New American Standard version, and it says, it's 1 Corinthians 1:9. God is faithful, through whom you were called into fellowship with his son Jesus Christ our Lord.
Okay, so let me just explain this then. He is faithful, and he calls us into a relationship, into a family, and into a relationship with Jesus Christ. And so that's what it's all about. He is faithful, and he has called us into a relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, I want to go to the next verse that I have for Sherry to read. Please read this.
2 Timothy 1:12 out of the King James Version. For the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Whew, love
okay.
that verse.
So it says, for I know whom I have believed. Okay, whom have I believed? I believe Jesus Christ. And my belief then is in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I know whom I have believed.
And am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day.
So, so our faith is in a person. It's not in five statements or 10 statements or 20 statements. Our faith is in a person. Now, he started the scripture by saying, I suffer these things and I'm not ashamed to suffer these things. Well, what was he talking about? Well, he's in prison. He was going to go to trial and he was going to be executed. He might not have known it was 100%, but it was certainly likely that he was going to be executed. He suffered all of these things, but he was not ashamed of it because he believed in a person. I believe in a person. And as Sherry said, I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed
unto
okay,
him.
Okay, so that word committed means I have entrusted something to Jesus.
Hallelujah.
See, faith is trusting in him. Now, we can easily say, I trust in him. But those are just mere words. And they don't mean anything.
That's right.
If you don't entrust something to him. If you don't commit something to him. But what we need to do is commit some things to him. What would we commit to him? Well, our life. Mm-hmm. Well, our health. Mm-hmm. Well, our relationships. Mm-hmm. Our family. Commit these things to him. See, if we hold on to other things, we hold them back and we don't commit them. For example, if we take our children, I just need to clear my throat. If we don't commit our children to the Lord, we're going to be anxious and fearful about them. So go ahead and commit your children to the Lord. If you don't commit your spouse to the Lord, then you will be trying to be in control of your spouse. Well, and that doesn't work very well. I can tell you that. I've been married to Sherry for 57 years, and I don't control her. I'd like to control her, but I don't control her. I commit her to the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I commit her to the Lord. And see, then I don't have to be worrying about that she does everything that I want her to do and that she does everything right and does everything perfect. I don't have to be concerned about that because I don't control her. I have committed her. I have entrusted her to the Lord.
What about the work, their work situation?
So we need to entrust everything.
Yeah,
the bottom line.
Amen.
Entrust your job to the Lord. So you're not in control. You don't have to worry about your job if you have entrusted it to the Lord.
Amen.
If you have committed it to the Lord. And your finances, if you have committed them to the Lord, you don't have to be concerned about them. You don't have to worry about them. You don't have to be anxious about them. Just commit it to the Lord. He said, I know whom I have believed in, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed to him. So commit everything to him and know that he is able to keep it. That's the way to get out of worry and anxiety
and stress.
And stress and depression is to commit everything to him. And see, we're looking at three words here. And this verse, see, 2 Timothy 1:12 says, I believe in him. And that's Jesus Christ. So I believe in him. I know in whom I have believed. And I have entrusted some things to him.
Let's stop right there for just a moment. The word that jumps out at me in this verse, but I know whom I have believed. That knowing means that there is a relationship there. I know Brother Fred because we've been together for many, many years. I know his thoughts and how he's going to respond and what he might say about something. But this verse says to know. I know in whom I have believed. And to me, that is a very important word there. It says that Adam knew Eve and she conceived. And so there's a relationship there that will produce something.
Amen. Amen. See, there are three different forms of faith in the Bible. The first form is the Christian way of life. And that is faith. And we know a lot of scriptures about faith. We've covered them before, but I'll just mention them. Romans 10, 17 says faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So when we hear the word of God, we have a capacity to believe. When we hear the word of God, we have a capacity to believe.
That's good.
Okay, and then Hebrews 11, 1, and it says that faith is the substance of things hoped for. Okay, those words, both of those words are P-I-S-T-I-S, P-I-S-T-I-S, pistis. Okay, but then you get to Galatians 5:22, and it talks about the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, gentleness, and it also has faith. In the King James, it's called faith, but in other translations, it's called faithfulness. Faith, but it's still the same Greek word, P-I-S-T-I-S, pistis. And so you may want to translate it different and say it's faithfulness, but in reality, it's the same Greek word as faith. Mm-hmm. So how does this faithfulness come, or this faith? How does it come? It comes by hearing the word.
Amen.
Hearing the word. And the word gives us the capacity. As we hear the word, it gives us the capacity. Okay. But now the fruit of the Spirit is faithfulness or faith, same word in the Greek. So it's faith or faithfulness. So let's talk about faithfulness for a minute. What is faithfulness? Well, Jesus said in Luke 16, verses 10 and 11, if you're faithful in little, you'll be faithful in much.
Hallelujah.
And if you're not faithful in the unrighteous mammon, or that's the word for money, if you're not faithful in money, who's going to give you the true riches? Okay, so faithfulness, but that's also the same word as faith. And so, when I began looking at this message, when I saw that our faith was in Jesus, it wasn't in a set of statements that I believe and you believe a different set of statements, but it's in a person. And we can all come into agreement that our faith is in that person, Jesus Christ. Okay, but when I looked at the Vine's dictionary of New Testament words, I find that faith is translated three different ways. It's translated trust, loyalty,
oh, wow,
and faithfulness.
Oh, wow.
Trust, loyalty, and faithfulness. Okay, so faithfulness is really important. God is the one who is faithful, and our faithfulness comes from him.
Whew, hallelujah.
We couldn't have faith. We couldn't be faithful without faith and trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what makes us faithful. We have his faith. He's given us faith. And so we cultivate faithfulness. It's by the Spirit of God. And so the fruit of the Spirit is by the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. And so we cultivate it little by little. and we have to be faithful in little things. Otherwise, we won't be faithful in much.
Things, yeah.
And so we start with little things. Cultivate faith. Okay. What do I mean by cultivate faith in little things? Well, when you make a promise to your family, fulfill that promise.
Amen.
Don't break that promise. If you make an appointment with someone, be there on time.
Hallelujah.
See, otherwise you break your promise. You're not faithful. If you're not faithful in the little things, you won't be faithful in much. Be faithful with your money. If you borrow money, repay it. If you have a bill, pay it on time. Don't see that's being faithful in little things. Amen. Pay your bills on time. Repay what you borrow.
Given to the kingdom.
All of these things, little by little, and that's going to grow your faith. That's going to grow your faith. He said in Luke, Jesus said in Luke 19:17, well done, the good and faithful servant.
Amen.
You've been faithful in a little.
Yes.
Be ruler over 10 cities. That is really, really, really exciting to me. That just our faithfulness, having faith in little things, being faithful in little things. And these three words mean faith: trust, loyalty, and faithfulness. Now let's look at this word loyalty. You know, a person that showed loyalty was Daniel. Throughout the book of Daniel, he served several different kings, and he was loyal to all of those kings. Now, when you look at his life, what happened was Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, sent an army in there and conquered Jerusalem. And killed so many people, but they brought back a few captives. And Daniel was one of those captives. And he was in a wicked, wicked, wicked nation under a wicked, wicked king. And yet he was loyal to him. One day, Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. And it was that the watchers had come down and they were going to cut a great tree. There had been this great tree grow. And that turned out to be a symbol of Nebuchadnezzar, but it was going to be cut off because there was going to be a judgment against the king. But this is what Daniel said. When he had the interpretation of it, he said, "Oh, king, I wish this were against your enemies." See, this is a wicked king. He's in there serving him, and he could easily have said, "I told you so. I told you so. You're wicked, and now you're going to be judged. You're going to be cut down." But Daniel said this incredible statement: "Oh, I wish this were against your enemies and against the people that hated you and not you." Blows my mind. Nebuchadnezzar was responsible for killing all of Daniel's family and bringing him in as a captive to be a servant to him. And yet he could say, "Oh, I wish this judgment wasn't coming against you." But he told him what it was. And so this is really important. And I want you to know that a lot of times you're put in a work situation around a lot of unbelievers. And a lot of people really get frustrated in that situation.
Right.
If they're in there with a bunch of people who are cussing and doing a lot of evil things and
corrupt things,
a lot of corrupt things, then they want to get out of there. They want to be, pray that I'll get a better job away from all of this evil. But you know, Daniel was in one of the most evil cities of all time, under one of the most evil kings of all time, and yet he was loyal to him. And because he was loyal to him, see, Nebuchadnezzar was judged, and he was put out like a beast, and he ate grass for 7 years, and he is away. But when he came to his senses, he recognized the Almighty God.
Hallelujah.
And I believe he recognized the Almighty God because of Daniel. Yeah,
and because of his loyalty.
Because of Daniel's loyalty to him. He knew Daniel. And he knew that the excellent spirit of the Most High God was in Daniel. And I believe that it turned Nebuchadnezzar's life around because a righteous man stood there beside an evil king. And so if you have been put into a work situation where there are evil people all around you doing evil things, perhaps God has intended to put you there to be the righteous seed, the holy seed among those unholy and unrighteous people.
Hallelujah.
Now, you might say, well, we don't see Daniel's faith. We don't see a reference to Daniel's faith. But let me tell you what we see about Daniel. We see his faithfulness.
Mm-hmm.
He prayed three times a day.
Amen.
He opened up those windows toward the east and he prayed three times a day. He was loyal. It talks about his loyalty. It talks about his faithfulness. And then some
people. And also the lions didn't eat him.
Then one day some people accused him of doing some things that he shouldn't do. And they threw him in the lion's den. But the lions didn't eat him because he did have faith. And that faith was exhibited and manifested
Amen.
Through his loyalty.
Amen.
Through his faithfulness. And through his trustworthiness,
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. So he did have faith, and the lions did not eat him. An angel shut their mouth. I want you to see how all of these concepts relate to each other. Trust, loyalty, mm-hmm. and faithfulness. And we see it all there in Daniel's life. And we see the consequences of it, that even when he was thrown in the lion's den, they did not eat him because his faith had already been tried with his loyalty, his trust, and his faithfulness. These are important concepts and they all relate together. And we need to have develop and cultivate this faithfulness because it is faith. And faithfulness, faith works by love. And that's the same word. It's P-I-S-T-I-S in the Greek. This message is very simple tonight, but it's also very robust because it gives us a broader perspective of what faith really is. It's not just a statement of some a set of statements that we agree with. It's we put our trust and faithfulness in a person, Jesus Christ. And because of that, we're going to be faithful to him. Out of his faithfulness, we can be faithful to him. And so we can commit things to him. We can commit everything to him. That's what he wants us to do. See, we have trust only if we entrust
Whoa, hallelujah.
Things to God.
Oh, that's good.
We have faith and we have trust only if we entrust things to God.
Amen.
It says, I know whom I have I have believed and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I committed to him. Or in other words, I entrusted to him. I entrusted my family to him. I entrusted my life to him. I entrust my salvation to him. I entrust my health to him. Now you might say, well, I don't entrust my health to him. I entrust my health to the doctors. But you know, there was a king called Asa.
Yeah.
And he looked first to the doctors.
Yeah, he sought the doctors.
Before he sought God. He sought the doctors. And he died because he sought the doctors before he sought God. So I'm not opposed to doctors, but I'm saying put them in the right priority. They are not
Amen.
Number one.
Amen.
God is number one.
Yes.
You need to entrust your body to God.
Amen.
And believe for healing And if you get to the point where you need something cut out, go to the doctor and have them cut it out. But you seek God first. Don't put doctors above God. Don't put your congregation above God. Don't put your trust in things above God. God is number one. I know whom I have believed.
Amen.
And that is a person, and the person is Jesus Christ. I trust him, and I trust him. You know I trust him if I entrust everything to him. And he knows that I trust him. But that's faith. If I entrust everything to him, that is faith. And if I'm loyal to him, see, people may come against you. They may criticize you. But if you're still loyal to him, see, Paul said, I'm not ashamed. I'm suffering all of these things. I'm in prison. I'm going to be tried. I'm going to be tried with my life hanging in the balance, but I'm not ashamed of all of this because I stand for Jesus Christ. That's where my faith is.
Hallelujah.
See, this message tonight is to help you have a broad perspective of what faith is. It's not just 5 or 10 little statements. I believe these things and I don't believe the other things. And so we need to believe Jesus Christ. And we need to cultivate faithfulness. We need to be faithful in the little things and cultivate that. And now, if we don't allow the Holy Spirit to operate in our life, how are we cultivating the fruit of faith or faithfulness? Because it's the same word. How do we cultivate that fruit if we do not allow the Holy Spirit to move in our life? Because faith and faithfulness, same word, are fruit of the Spirit.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. We have to rely on the Holy Spirit to cultivate these things. So just to summarize then, and I'm bringing this to conclusion. These three words all mean faith. And faith and these three things are interchangeable. So if I have faith, then I'm going to trust Jesus Christ. I'm going to be loyal to him, and I'm not going to deny him. And even if I am around people and they're drinking and cussing, and I'm not going to fall into that crowd, and I'm not going to do what they do just because they're doing it, and I want to blend in. See, I'm not going to deny Jesus Christ, but I'm going to stand up for what is right and stand up for Jesus Christ. And because I believe in him, that's where my faith is. And it's so rewarding and so enlightening to realize I don't have to find the 10 right statements and say, this is what I believe and this is faith, but I have to find Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And I don't find him, but he found me. He found me when I was lost and when I was broken, my heart was broken. He found me and I accepted him and he gave me faith so that I could be saved. Hallelujah. All of these words are interchangeable. Faith, trust, loyalty, and faithfulness. All three of those words mean faith. And so let's have faith towards Jesus Christ. To me, it takes a lot of the pressure off. I don't have to search the scriptures and find out exactly which verse I believe and which one I disagree with. I just believe the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for being here today.
Amen. Amen.
I'm going to turn it over to Sherry.
Well, I think about another man, another patriarch in the Word of God that was persuaded. And it says so in Romans chapter 4, Abraham was fully persuaded. He was fully persuaded because he was a friend of God. And he knew God, that if God told him something, that God was faithful to bring it to pass. And that was that he was going to be the father of many nations. Hallelujah. And he waited and he waited and he waited. And some people give up too quick. Oh, well, it didn't happen, you know, when I thought it was going to happen. oh, it's not happening soon enough for me. But let me tell you something. He waited 25 years for Isaac. He didn't give up. He was fully persuaded. And this says, Paul says, I'm persuaded that God is able. God's able to get me out of prison. God is able to do this. He's able to do that. And do you believe that? Do you truly believe that in your life, God is able to do what needs to be done to help you go forward?